Well, hello and welcome. I'm Ted Peterson. I'm a professor of computer science at the University of Minnesota Duluth. And today is Tuesday, May 10th, 2016. And we're kind of hitting the summertime here, and at least for university calendars. And I'm sometimes asked, what are good books to read about the history of computing? Books that not only give me a sense of the personalities involved, but some of the underlying technology and ideas. And, surprising how often I'm asked that. So I did some thinking, and I thought I came up with my top three books that I would recommend to read if you want to get a sense about the history of computing, development of computer technology, computing architecture, and some of the underlying ideas that are important to computer science. And so I've got three books, and I want to first just go through the books quickly, and then I'll spend a little bit of time talking about each of them. So if you're just looking for three books to run out and get, you can stop after like the next minute or so and get those. Otherwise, I'll say more about each of them. And so here we go. Number three is, it's a book called The Soul of a New Machine by Tracy Kidder. And this book was a bestseller around 1980. It won the Pulitzer Prize. It has been in print ever since. I recently saw an Everyman's Classic Edition is coming out. So this book has kind of entered the canon, if you will, of nonfiction writing. And it's a great book. It describes the development of a mini computer system at Data General in the late 1970s, and does a wonderful job of getting into some of the underlying problems and technology that go with that. And so it's a real wonderfully accessible view of computer architecture and developing computer systems. So that's number three. So number two, more recent book about, it's called The Thrilling Adventures of Lovelace and Babbage, by Sidney Padua. This is a wonderful book, and this is actually, interestingly enough, it's more like a graphic novel, really. But it's about Charles Babbage and Ada Lovelace. Charles Babbage developed designs for both a difference engine and an analytical engine from 1820s up until nearly 1850. Machines that were never built, but that captured the essence of computing, and Ada Lovelace helped understand and explain what we could do with general purpose computing devices in a really wonderful way. And this book is really a tremendously clear exposition of the ideas behind the analytical engine, and talks about their life and times, and also engages in a bit of sort of alternate history and leads our two heroines into a happier future, happier than the one that they actually lived through, sadly enough. But this is a wonderful book. Just get this book and get the other one too. So that's number two. Number one, maybe not too much of a surprise. This is a well-known book. It is not just a good book about computing and technology. It is a great book. It is a great biography, period. And that's, of course, Alan Turing, The Enigma, by Andrew Hodges. This is the definitive biography of Alan Turing. It is, you'll see it, it's in print. It's been in print for 20 years at least now. And you'll see it in bookstores now with the sort of intense glare of Benedict Cumberbatch staring back at you, because this book was tied into the movie The Imitation Game, which came out, I guess, 2 years ago now, which isn't a bad movie, actually, but if you saw the movie or you're wondering about Alan Turing, you really need to read this book to get a better picture of Alan Turing, the man. He really did pioneer our understanding of what computers can and can't do. He was heroic in World War II in breaking codes, breaking the Nazi Enigma code, and was a pioneer in the development of electronic stored program computers after World War II. Tragically, of course, as we may know, he committed suicide on the very close to his 42nd birthday, and this book talks about not just Alan Turing, the scientist and war hero, but also talks about Alan Turing the man, and so it's an important book to read. So highly recommend it. I'm really glad I have a copy that doesn't have Benedict Cumberbatch staring back at me. I would find that disconcerting. So maybe if you feel the same, look on eBay or whatever. So those are the top three. Now I want to spend a little bit of time talking about each of them to explain why I include them. And I'm going to start at number three. I'm going to start at The Soul of a New Machine and say a little bit more about the book and what it's about. And so it focuses on the development of what were then known as mini computers. And mini computers were very important in the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, up into the 1990s. And this was really a class of machine that was an alternative to the very expensive IBM mainframes that kind of dominated the landscape of computing in the 1950s, 1960s, 70s, 80s. And so they were a lower cost system that could support multiple users and scientific computing, and so became very popular in universities and research labs and so forth. And as a result, had a kind of out of proportion influence on the direction of computing, because everybody who studied computer science learned about computing on mini computers back in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. And that included people like Bill Gates, Steve Wozniak, and yours truly for that matter. So I'm not trying to take on airs here, but it's the truth. So the mini computer business was like any computing business, pretty fierce. And the big player in mini computers was Digital Electronics Corporation, DEC. DEC was founded in about 1958 in Massachusetts, and specifically was trying to sort of find that sweet spot to provide high performance interactive computing at a cost much lower than IBM mainframes. And became successful with that. They had a line of computers called the PDP, PDP 1 through PDP 11, that were enormously popular and enormously influential. By the time we get to the mid-1970s, however, DEC had a bit of a problem with their PDP lines in that they were all incompatible. You couldn't take a program written on one of the PDPs and run it on the other without some kind of modification. And so that kind of fragmented their market and their customer base. And so they wanted to try and unify all of their systems under a new architecture that would be consistent. And that was the VAX. And the VAX was DEC's big bet on the future. They were betting the company on the VAX system. And the idea was they would get all of their customers moving to VAX. It would be a compatible line of computers, and they would keep people in the DEC family, and people would buy DEC computers for generations, and on and on and on. Well, now, there's a good chance you may not have heard of the VAX, you may not have heard of Digital Electronics, so you kind of know the bet didn't work out, right? So they played their hand and lost. By 1998, DEC ceased to exist as an entity, 95-98. So something happened. However, in the mid-1970s, DEC was the big player in the minicomputer market. It was a billion-dollar company. And if you wanted to compete in the minicomputer space, you competed with DEC. And so Data General was a competitor of DEC. It was formed by several brilliant engineers from DEC in the late 1960s who wanted to do some things a little different than what DEC did. They felt DEC was getting a little conservative, and so they wanted to go out and try and do something different. And that company was Data General. And this book is the story of Data General's effort to build a mini computer that would compete with the VAX. And it's a wonderful story. It's told in very dramatic terms. And there's a lot of interesting technology here. Low-level computer architecture, talking about instruction set architectures, talking about microprogramming. And even if you're familiar with those ideas, it does so in a way that is really accessible. And so one example that sticks with me is about microprogramming. What is microprogramming? And it's, well, here's the analogy that's made in this book, which I think is really effective. In Old English, apparently there wasn't a single word for fight There wasn't a word for fight. So if you were a poet writing about a fight, you needed to describe the fight. And that's kind of what microprogramming does. It is what microprogramming does. Microprogramming is when you have an instruction that you want your computer to run that isn't directly supported in the hardware. How do you make it do that? You write a microprogram that uses what your computer has to put together that instruction that you want. So it's like using the words you know to describe fight without using the word fight. It's just a brilliant analogy, and this book is full of those. And so even if you know a lot about computer architecture, this book gives you some ideas about how to explain that and how to think about it that are really accessible. So this is just a wonderful book. I strongly recommend it. It's number three, for goodness sake. So I highly recommend this book. Now, this copy comes to us from the Duluth Public Library, by the way. I get a lot of books at the Duluth Public Library, and a lot of computing books, actually, so it's a good place to go for that. So now, a little bit more about the times here, the environment, this Data General versus VAX competition. Data General did produce this, the machine described in this book. It was called the Eclipse, and it went on to become very successful. Data General made a lot of money in the 1980s and was indeed a competitor with DEC. Now DEC, as I said, kind of bet the company on the VAX, and in the 1980s at least, that bet worked out. And a lot of people, a lot of systems were purchased. I think 100,000 VAX systems were sold, a lot to universities and research labs and so forth, and were used up until the 1990s. And I remember as a PhD student in about 1996, I think, when the VAX 11780 system was actually taken out finally at Southern Methodist University. I remember it quite vividly. Part of the reason for that is that the VAX 11780 is the system that I primarily learned computing on as an undergraduate in computer science. I studied VAX 11780 assembly language from this very book. And VAX 11780 assembly language is wonderful. It is the last of a breed in a way where it was an assembly language written for humans to write. Assembly languages now are more written for compilers to write, more automated, but this is back when humans wrote assembly language code, and it was great. And so I keep this book with me just in case. For me at least, this was one of my favorite subjects in undergraduate computer science education, and I shared that fact during a job interview with Shell Oil. And I don't remember for sure, but I think they might have tented their fingers, because you couldn't find too many, you know, 20 some odd year computer science students who wanted to do assembly language programming. It was a little unusual, but I loved it, and I said so. And they had a job for me, and this was in Houston at Shell Oil, and I was an IBM assembly language programmer. Now, we didn't use IBM mainframes, we used OMDAL mainframes, which were a clone, if you will, but they used the IBM instruction set, and as a part of that, this is a special treat for hanging in here. I got one of these. Yeah, that's right. This is an IBM System 370 reference summary. And this contains a concise summary of the IBM instruction set architecture for their mainframe lines, the 370, 370XA. And I got this like on my first day of work at Shell Oil Company. And this might not have been the original one, because this one's in pretty good shape. But I got this at some point during my time at Shell. And how many people do you know that actually have one of these? They're not many. Most people who worked on assembly language programming are now deceased, because it's kind of an old-time thing. But anyway, I have this. Interesting bit of trivia here. This is the same size as an IBM punch card. If you've heard about punch cards, this is how big they were. Great thing about it, fits right into a pocket, so I can carry that proudly. I don't do that very often because, I don't know, just it's, I'm going to drop that. We're still talking about the soul of a new machine and mini computers and the tremendous influence they had on computing and computer science. Why don't we still have mini computers? Why don't we have this class of computers now that's kind of below, let's say, like a data center cloud and above a personal computer like we all have on our desktops now. Well, the reality is that personal computers have become so powerful that they have supplanted the mini computer and workstation market, and pretty much everything now is, in a sense, a kind of personal computer. So there's not really a space available for a separate kind of architecture with separate processors and instruction sets as an alternative to the personal computer, because the personal computer as we view it now is serving so many roles. Those data centers that Google and Facebook have are just filled up with thousands upon thousands of personal computers that are networked together. And so the mini computer space essentially vanished with the advent of technology. And so by 2000, nobody was talking much about mini computers. That said, the principles of computer architecture that are described in The Soul of a New Machine and the ideas, the problem solving, is all highly relevant, and it reads really well today. So a wonderful book, highly recommended. So now moving on to number two, that is, as you recall, The Thrilling Adventures of Lovelace and Babbage by Sidney Padua. This is my own personal copy of this book. I bought this, and I don't buy a lot of books. I get a lot of books from a library, or I get them free because I'm a professor, which don't like to tell anybody. But anyway, I bought this book. And I really like it. I originally got this book or saw this book at the Duluth Public Library. I was preparing for last semester's class in computer architecture, history of computing, and I was looking for material about Charles Babbage, and I found this. And I was stunned, actually, at first I didn't take it seriously. I thought, oh, this is gonna be goofy. This is like, you know, it's gonna be just kind of fiction. But in fact, it's not. There's a lot of content and a lot of interesting details about how the different machines of Babbage, of Charles Babbage, actually worked. And it's just a lot of fun too. So Charles Babbage in the 1820s began to build, or design at least, what he called a difference engine. And difference engines were essentially very large calculators that could compute the value of polynomial expressions. And that turned out to be a really important problem to solve at the time. These were used for creating tables of logarithms and other mathematical tables that were used in computing ship navigation and so forth. And so it was important to get it right. And Charles Babbage was a perfectionist. Oh my God. And he wanted to build a machine that would accurately compute and print values of polynomials, and that was his difference engine. He got tremendous support from the British government to construct difference engines, but was in the end unable to do so. He grew frustrated with his workman, his engineer, and I think his attention wandered, and so he began to focus on his analytical engine. The ideas for an analytical engine, which was a vaster enterprise, and it was in effect a general purpose computer made from gears and punched cards and powered by steam. So this was starting in the early 1830s, about 40 years before the electric light bulb. Okay, so we're in a whole different space here, and we have someone designing what is equivalent to a modern computer. It's kind of breathtaking. Now, his designs were detailed, and they were workable. In recent years, there was a reconstruction of one of the difference engines from his designs that works. You can see that. The analytical engine has not been reconstructed or constructed, but there's talk of doing that. But it seems quite certain that the fundamental ideas there are very sound. And so Charles Babbage was a wonderful designer of machinery and hardware and computers and so forth, but he wasn't necessarily a great organizer, and he wasn't, sadly, much of a writer, at least about his technical work. And so we don't necessarily know a whole lot from Charles Babbage directly about his machines. That's where our friend Ada Lovelace jumps into the picture. Ada Lovelace met Charles Babbage when Ada was a teenager. This was in the late 1820s, I believe, and she was a wonderful, curious, funny, very intelligent young woman who was very much a woman of her times, very constrained by her times. She was wealthy. She was the only legitimate child of Lord Byron, who essentially abandoned his family after siring Ada. And so she grew up without a father. She grew up in a time where women had a very prescribed role, and her role was to get married, have children. Mathematics was not really something that ladies did, but she did. And she pursued it with great passion. She met Charles Babbage at one of his many famous soirees where he was demonstrating the difference engine, and she kind of got it, and that kind of clicked. And that scene is portrayed very nicely. I mean, it's this is one of the things I like about this book is it's a very affectionate book, I think, about Charles Babbage and Ada Lovelace are treated here as maybe difficult yet likable characters. And sometimes you read about Charles Babbage and it's like, oh, he was a monster, and Ada Lovelace, oh, she was she didn't really do anything. She couldn't think on her own. She stole everything from Babbage. Very cynical. And this book is not cynical. And I love that about this book. I don't like cynical books. And this is a warm, affectionate treatment of two people that really need that. In any case, Ada Lovelace became a correspondent, if you will, with Charles Babbage and explored ideas with him, and also I think provided a kind of organizing force in his life. He was a scattered fellow. He did a lot of wonderful work on a lot of different things, actually. He studied mathematics at Cambridge. He became the Lucasian professor of mathematics at Cambridge. Was that for 10 years. Same position held by Isaac Newton before him, Stephen Hawking after him. So he was a smart man. But he was also kind of all over the place. You know, he's a wealthy man with a curious, wide-ranging mind. And, you know, who knows where that leads. This book really brings so much of that to life, and it also makes numerous references to a lot of important source material that I think encourages us to go back and look more deeply at these people. And I think that's a wonderful service of this book. It talks a lot about this paper, Sketch of the Analytical Engine, invented by Charles Babbage. This is how we know Ada Lovelace. Charles Babbage did not write much about the difference engine during his life. He also did not give many talks or presentations, but he did give one in the early 1840s talking about his analytical engine, and in attendance was L.F. Manabria, who decided to write up these notes and essentially publish them as a record of the presentation. And he wrote this in French, and Ada Lovelace translated it. And that was one thing a lady could do. She could translate, at least. Her name did not appear in the original publication, just initials, translations by AAL, I think, Ada Augusta Lovelace, or AAK at that time, Ada Augusta King, probably. But in any case, her translation by itself was important. But then she really went to town, and she added the notes by the translator. And the notes by the translator are double the length of the paper. And they are, I would say they're brilliant. And I've read these notes numerous times. And I've read them from a perspective of someone who does know about computing, computer science, has studied it, taught it, so on and so forth. And one of the remarkable things to me about this is that it reads so reasonably from my perspective of the early 21st century. She wrote this 170 years ago, and she's talking about computing and programming and the limits and possibilities of computing. And there's not too much there that strikes a wrong note. And that's remarkable, because remember, the difference engine and the analytical engine were never even built. She never saw them. She never touched them. She never used them. All of this was a mental construction for her, for Babbage. And yet, she was able to talk so precisely about programming such a machine, and then about more general limits of computing. And in fact, she sort of foreshadows Turing by talking about the possibilities of computing beyond just doing equations, a more symbolic representation. She didn't discover the universal Turing machine, no. But she was heading in that direction, thinking in those kinds of terms. And that's just astonishing. I mean, people after Alan Turing presented that idea still, in some cases, didn't get it. And so she got it before the idea was really even there, which I think is brilliant. This picture of her is not in the original publication. This is a version you'll find on the web. If you do a search for the sketch of the analytical engine, you'll find this, and it's a nice copy. But that's a portrait of Ada Augusta, looking rather glamorous. There's one or two photographs of her where she looks far less glamorous. She had a lot of health problems, actually, and ended up dying very tragically young, which we'll talk about, which is a sad end. But there are a lot of fascinating points in this, in her notes, and one of them, I think in many ways the most stunning, in a sense, is this idea of going beyond just mathematical calculations, but doing more symbolic computation. So let me just read this, you can get a flavor of what she writes like. I think it's marvelous. The operating mechanism can even be thrown into action independently of any object to operate upon, although of course no result could then be developed. Again, it, the analytical engine, might act upon other things besides number, were objects found whose mutual fundamental relations could be expressed by those of the abstract science of operations, and which should be also susceptible of adaptations to the action of the operating notion and mechanisms of the engine. Supposing, for instance, that the fundamental relations of pitched sounds in the science of harmony and of musical composition were susceptible of such expression and adaptations, the engine might compose elaborate and scientific pieces of music of any degree of complexity or extent. Music. I mean, this is 40 years before the light bulb, 30 years before the electric light bulb, 100 years before we had anything resembling an electronic computer. And we're talking about music and symbolic computation. It's a wonderful vision, and a vision that came true. She got it right. Yeah. So, you know, sometimes you go back read stuff from 1960 about what life would be like in the year 2000, and it's preposterous. It's like cities under the sea, jetpacks, you know. A lot of the times that stuff about the future doesn't read very well, even a few years later. This reads marvelously. This is really brilliant. There are other interesting sections here. I think one that's important. Note G. She letters her endnotes. She assigns letters to her endnotes, and this is where I think you can see her really understanding the nature and limits of computing. And I'll just read a little bit of this, but she says, "It is desirable to guard against the possibility of exaggerated ideas that might arise as to the powers of the analytical engine. In considering any new subject, there is frequently a tendency first to overrate what we find to be already interesting or remarkable, and secondly, by a sort of natural reaction, to undervalue the true state of the case when we do discover what our notions have surpassed those that were really tenable. The analytical engine has no pretensions whatever to originate anything. It can do whatever we know how to order it to perform. It can follow analysis, but it has no power of anticipating any analytical relations or truths." Wow. That's such a sane, competent view of computing. And you can go search on the internet now. Artificial intelligence, you're going to take over and kill us and do terrible things that we never imagined. Ada Lovelace speaks to us from 1843 and says sensibly enough, machines will do what we tell them. That's how it works. And I would say she gets that right. And I know that is disappointing to science fiction writers and everybody else, but that's the truth. And she envisioned that without having ever seen any kind of a computing device in her life. I mean, it's remarkable. And so there is a certain quibbling kind of person who sort of likes to try and dismiss Ada Lovelace, which I don't get. Ada Lovelace has a day now set aside for her December 10th, which was her birthday. She deserves the day, right? Let's give her the day. And also some respect. This is a wonderful bit of writing. Some these quarrelsome sorts say, well, she got all her ideas from Babbage, blah, blah, blah. The truth is, Charles Babbage, an adult thinking person, chose not to write down a lot of what he did and thought. And so, you know what? That wasn't Ada Lovelace's fault. That's on Charles Babbage. And it's actually, you know, he was a wonderful designer of hardware and so forth. He didn't do a good job sort of documenting his ideas and his work, and that's on him. And so we shouldn't be taking that out on Ada Lovelace. And I think if you look at some of her correspondence with Charles Babbage, you can see that she was not simply being led around by Charles Babbage, not at all. We'll see some examples of that here. So this is, if you read this book, I think you're going to be inspired to at least look at this paper, which I think you should, because this is why we know about Ada Lovelace. This is why we know about the analytical engine. We'll see that it turns out Alan Turing knew all about this paper, by the way, and that turns out to be important. So you should look at that paper. As we read this book, one of the things, it's an affectionate portrait, and you can see in this book that Charles Babbage is a kind of frustrating, difficult man who feels very sort of put upon and victimized, despite being given hundreds of thousands of pounds by the British government, and despite being a wealthy man, despite having many advantages in life. Now, it is true, he also had a sad life. His wife died when she was only, I think, 36. He lived the rest of his life as a widower. Many of his children died before him, some of them as in their childhoods. So his life was not all, there was sadness there, and there was loss, I guess, as there is in any life. But that said, this book does a nice job of kind of poking a little bit of fun at Charles Babbage and his sort of put upon nature. It also includes some source material here in the back of the book, which I think may inspire you to investigate a little bit more about Charles Babbage himself. He's an interesting man. He was a perfectionist, right? His designs reflect that, and his attitudes reflect that too. And so even as a young, on-the-make, up-and-coming scientist, he's out speaking the truth as he sees it, you know, without regard to whatever consequences might exist. And so one example of this is Charles Babbage, Reflections on the Decline of Science in England. Now, this book comes to us from the Interlibrary Loan Service of the University of Minnesota, by the way, which I requested it from, and they got it apparently from Indiana University Library, South Bend. So we thank all these people who brought this book to us. And this is Charles Babbage taking on the scientific establishment of England and basically arguing it's all wrong. It's structured wrong, the ethics are wrong, it's all wrong. Now, he actually has some reasonable points here. But when you are a member of a scientific community or a community of any kind, and you want to achieve reform, yes, there may be a sort of place for the bull in the china shop approach, but oftentimes it's going to alienate people, and that's what Charles Babbage managed to do. Let me give you a flavor of his work here and why it might have been a little offensive. There's a chapter, Frauds of Observers, Section 3, on the Frauds of Observers. Scientific inquiries are more exposed than most others to the inroads of pretenders, and I feel that I shall deserve the thanks of all who really value truth by stating some of the methods of deceiving practiced by unworthy claimants for its honor, whilst the mere circumstance of their arts being known may deter future offenders. There are several species of impositions that have been practiced in science which are but little known except to the initiated, and which it may perhaps be possible to render quite intelligible to ordinary understandings. These may be classed under the heads of hoaxing, forging, trimming, and cooking. He's kind of talking about manipulation of data and scientific experiments here. And you know what? He makes a lot of good points. He actually has a case here, but it's made in such a way that you could only find it offensive if you're a member of that community. And so this characterized his nature. He was not at all a diplomat. He saw truth, spoke it as he saw it, and brooked no compromise. Later in his life, he wrote his autobiography. It's called Passages from the Life of a Philosopher. This comes to us from the University of Minnesota, Twin Cities Science and Engineering Library. So very nice, thank you. And it's a curious book, and it's in a way marvelous because he talks about all sorts of different things in his life, but not very much about the analytical or the difference engine. And sadly enough, that deficiency matters. We would have benefited quite a lot had he chosen to write down more about what he was thinking and when he was thinking it. Instead, for example, there's an entire chapter on picking locks and deciphering. Now, interestingly enough, Charles Babbage was actually a fairly accomplished code breaker, so maybe that's a reasonable thing to include. But as we get on in this book, he has a chapter, The Author's Contributions to the to Human Knowledge. Scientific societies, analytical society, astronomical society at Cambridge, origin of the statistical society, principles of taxation, extension to elections, the two pumps, monopoly, miracles, all kinds of things. Some of them, actually, his work on reforming science in England was actually fairly important, and so there's a case to be made here that should be discussed. But no mention of the analytical engine or the difference engine. We go on. Next chapter, the author's further contributions to human knowledge. So, kind of a second pass. And he talks about all kinds of things. Glaciers, uniform postage, weight of the Bristol bags, parcel post. He was really into mail, and I think came up with the idea of charging a fixed rate. It sort of simplified things and ended up being more profitable. Plan for transmitting letters along aerial wires. Why not? Cost of verification is part of price. Sounds sensible. Submarine navigation, and then difference engine, analytical engine. A couple of pages turned over at the end of his autobiography to really what I think we would agree is kind of his masterwork. Games of skill, tic-tac-toe. He actually talks more about tic-tac-toe, I think, than he does the analytical engine. So, what a curious man. It's easy to judge others, and we should resist that urge, I think. I don't know why he chose, to not write more about his analytical and difference engine, but he did do some wonderful design work. And Ada Lovelace kind of steps into the void and at least provides some description of that. So that's more background about Charles Babbage. Ada Lovelace, I think, is a fascinating person. She had a short life. She died at 36, but in that time made some fundamental lasting contributions to computing. And was also a wife and mother and a lady of society and so forth. And I guess because of her position, and maybe just the nature of such families, a lot of her correspondence has been preserved, and so there are efforts underway now to kind of really collect that and make that into a comprehensive resource that we can look at and learn more about her. In the meantime, there's a very nice book called Ada, the Enchantress of Numbers, that this comes to us from the University of Minnesota, in the Twin Cities. This book is a collection, a selection of her letters, along with some commentary about different parts of her life. And the letters are lovely because they give us a sense of Ada Lovelace, the person. And I have a few that I just wanted to share just because I find them so interesting and charming, really. Here's a letter to Lady Byron, that's her mother, dated 29th of October, 1835. So she's in her teens, but old enough to be married by now, so late teens, I believe. And it says, "My dear hen," that's her mother, "you are not a good hen today, and I shall peck at you. I think Mrs. Carpenter mistaken in her taste about my hair. She insists on its being either quite plain or in curls, and to my fancy much too short. I think scarcely reaching as low as my ear, so that I should be like a crop-cared dog. I conclude she is bent on displaying the whole expanse of my capacious jawbone, upon which I think the word mathematics should be written. The coronation robes are fixed upon, and I am to have the bandeau of diamonds on my head. I wish you were here, for I think your advice would be valuable. Your very affectionate little bird, A.A.K., Ada Augusta King. King was her married name. And so that's just charming. I mean, I think a very warm sort of note and feeling from that. We can also see in some of these letters the nature of her relationships with Charles Babbage. And this is a wonderful one. This is a letter to Charles Babbage, Tuesday afternoon, August 1st, 1843. And so this was around the time she was preparing her notes for the Menabrea paper. And she writes from Ockham and says, I am half beside myself with hurry and work. I could not get anything done in time to send by coach this morning, and now I am obliged still to retain one sheet, which, however, I hope to send you by an occasion tomorrow afternoon. Note B has plagued me to death, although I have made but little alteration to it. Such alterations as there are, however, happen to have been very tiresome, and to have demanded minute consideration and very nice adjustments. It is a very excellent note. I wish you were as accurate and as much to be relied on as I am myself. You might often save, underline for emphasis, me much trouble if you were, whereas you, in reality, add to my trouble not infrequently, and there is at any rate always the anxiety of doubting if you will not get me into a scrape even when you don't. By the way, I hope you do not take it upon yourself to alter any of my corrections. I must beg you not. They have all some very sufficient reason, and you have made a pretty mess and confusion in one or two places, which I will show you sometime, where you have ventured into my manuscript to insert or alter a phrase or word and utterly muddled the sense. I could not conceive at first in one or two places what had happened to my sentences, though I soon saw they were patchwork and not my own, and found it so on referring to the manuscript. I fear you will think this a very cross letter. Never mind. I am a good little thing after all. Yours ever, A.A.L., Ada Augusta Lovelace. Later, P.S., it is impossible to send you anything but notes B and C, and this partly owing to some wrong references and blunderations of your own. Do not be afraid, for I will work like the devil early tomorrow morning. So this is great. And I think anyone who has tried to make the argument that she was following Charles Babbage around like a puppy or something, I think needs to read this. And also the word blunderation, that we need to revive that. That's a great word. That's a great letter. As mentioned, Ada Lovelace had a sad end. She died at 36 of uterine cancer, a very painful death. And near the end of her life, she apparently confessed certain sins to her husband, which caused him to become estranged for the last few years of, for a few months of her life. And her mother also chose to kind of restrict her visitors just to her physicians. And so the last few years of her life, or months, I keep saying years, last few months she was isolated and separated from her husband, her friends, and died essentially with her mother and her doctors. Her last visitor, interestingly, was Charles Dickens, the Charles Dickens, right? And this is recounted in this book, Ada, the Enchantress of Numbers, and it's quite a touching scene. On 19th August, Ada requested Charles Dickens to come and read the death scene of the little boy from Dombey and Son. End quote. This is that scene. Now the boat was out at sea, but gliding smoothly on, and now there was a shore before him. The golden ripple on the wall came back again, and nothing else stirred in the room. The old, old fashion, the fashion that came in with our first garments and will last unchanged until our race has run its course and the wide firmament is rolled up like a scroll. The old, old fashion, death. That's the end of that passage. And then it says, Dickens walked out of her room impressed and touched by Ada's courage and bravery. He was the last non-family member other than Lady Byron's friends and physicians to see her alive. It's a tragic story. She died quite young, had ideas towards the end of her life about, for example, developing some kind of calculus of the nervous system, a kind of mathematical model of the nervous system, and not to be realized, and to die estranged from her husband, painfully. I mean, that's the truth. It's very sad. And we also have Charles Babbage, living a full life, 70 years, but for many of those years alone, and many of his children gone before him, and not building his difference engines or his analytical engine, nothing realized. He felt himself to be a failure because of this. And that seems a harsh judgment, but that's what he thought. And so I think the wonderful thing, another wonderful thing this book does, is it imagines a happier ending to this story. It imagines Charles Babbage and Ada Lovelace having built their engines, not having health problems, and living out a kind of alternate ending to their lives, where they are working, engaged in adventures and crime fighting, and it's just wonderful. And it's the kind of thing that I think in life, you know, there are oftentimes endings in life, or, you know, things don't work out as we wish always. And it's nice to kind of see that Sidney Padua has taken such a situation in hand and given it a much nicer ending. And it's very clear in this book, by the way, which episodes are constructions of Sidney Padua, which actually happened. I mean, there's no danger of confusion here. And so, and despite the alternate history feel, there's a lot of good solid content here. So this is really a wonderful book. And so that was number two. Now, after all of that, can number one actually be a better book? Well, number one is a pretty good book. Number one is a really good book. And in fact, I read a lot of biographies. I love biographies. And this is it's not my favorite biography. My favorite biography is biography of Frida Kahlo by Hayden Herrera. You see all the Frida stuff, right? This is very close. This is as good a biography. It may actually be a better biography. But this is a wonderful book. And so even if you're not that interested in computing, this is worth reading, because it talks about Alan Turing the man, a young man who was brilliant and yet had a very difficult life in many ways. He was gay, I think knew he was gay from an early age, was fairly open about it, which was unusual, I think, for the time. Was mercilessly bullied. There are some horrific scenes of bullying in this book that are just heartbreaking, actually, to imagine that such things could happen. And yet he carried on. There's an important relationship in Alan Turing's life, a kind of sort of unrequited love of another young man who tragically died. And so Alan Turing, you know, by the time he goes to university, has endured not a pleasant sort of adolescence, young adulthood, but he goes to Cambridge, and it's like lightning strikes. He does this amazing thing where he solves one of the open problems in mathematics, David Hilbert's decision problem, which was basically just asking, is there a sort of automatic or algorithmic way to determine if a problem is solvable or not? Everybody thought the answer to that was yes. Alan Turing proved the answer is no. Sort of rocked mathematics back on its heels. And he did this as a university student. So he was 23, 24 years old. And what he did was he wrote this paper. And look at that title, Uncomputable Numbers with an Application to the Entscheidungsproblem. That's German for decision problem. Right there, you're scared by the title. And this is actually a very difficult paper. This is a paper I've aspired to read for years, and I keep trying. And it's demanding, but it's brilliant. And what it does is that it creates this abstract notion of a computer called a universal machine, or now a universal Turing machine, that defines what can be done with a computer. And it theoretically defines the notion of a stored program computer. And it uses that to prove this mathematical concept, or to answer this mathematical question about the decision problem. And so it's like the foundations of computer science come about as a side effect to solving a math problem. And it's stunning. And the more you understand this paper, the more remarkable it becomes. Now, as I've confessed, I can't read this on its own and understand it. There are some, if you're really determined, you can do it, though. I recommend very highly this book, Charles Petzold's The Annotated Turing. This takes you line by line through this paper and explains it. And so you need this book. And it still is rough sledding, but this helps. There's also a very lovely and accessible introduction to what Turing proved in this book, The Universal Computer. And this actually talks about the creation of computing from a theoretical point of view, taking us through developments of mathematics and logic up to Alan Turing, and really does a nice job of conveying what is so brilliant about this paper. This book is written by Martin Davis, a mathematician, but it's wonderfully clear. And probably if you're sort of intrigued by, well, what is this proof that Alan Turing did? What's this Turing machine idea? Read this. And then if you still like that, maybe, then read this and try and fight your way through that paper. And you'll be glad you did. But this is work Alan Turing did by the time he was 24, 25 years old, where he essentially remakes the foundations of mathematics and defines the foundations of computer science. What do you do after that? Well, in Alan Turing's case, a loyal subject of the British Empire, World War II breaks out in 1939. This paper is from 1936. He did some work at Princeton as a mathematician, theoretical work. But in 1939, he was in England. World War II broke out. He goes to work breaking codes. And that's the title of this book, The Enigma. It's a bit of a metaphor, I suppose, or what have you. Enigma is the code that he broke during World War II, that the Nazis used to, among other things, control their U-boat movements. And so breaking that code was a huge victory in the war, and saved untold numbers of lives. But it's also the notion of Alan Turing the man as kind of an enigma, hard to figure. One of the things that I've learned in reading and listening to videos and such about Alan Turing is that we don't actually have any video or audio of him, which has always struck me as being so sad. He died in 1954, so it would have been eminently possible for that to exist, but it just doesn't seem to. And so, if you quarrel with Benedict Cumberbatch a little bit, well, it's not like Benedict Cumberbatch had a big video archive that he could refer to in terms of adapting to Alan Turing's mannerisms and speech and so forth. So, we'll have to give him some just credit for that. But in any case, this book does a brilliant job of describing these theoretical advances as well. And so certainly if you read this, you'll come away with a decent understanding of what's here. And then it goes on to talk about the Enigma work. And it talks about the Enigma machine and how it works, and talks about code breaking, and you learn so much. And it captures the excitement and the drama of it. I mean, thousands of lives were at stake. The British Empire was on its heels. And Alan Turing had a lot to do with turning the course of the war in 1940 through the breaking of the Enigma code finally. And so truly heroic work described here. And then, after World War II, there's kind of a little known, the least known part of Alan Turing's life, I suppose, might be that period after World War II where he was involved in trying to build the first stored program electronic computer. And he was not successful in that, but was certainly involved in one of the early efforts, trying to build the ACE system at the National Physical Laboratory, and then moved to Manchester when the Manchester baby became the first operational stored program computer. He moved there to work with that computer and was writing programs on it to play chess and do problems in biology and all kinds of wonderful things. And that is, of course, where his life ended. He was a gay man at a time when it was illegal simply to be gay. And a relationship he had with a young working class man came to light. And he was prosecuted for that and sentenced to a term of chemical castration, which he served. And then at some point after that, made the decision to take his own life, which we don't know why. And it's one of those most deeply personal kinds of decisions of a man who didn't necessarily reveal all of his thoughts and secrets, and so we don't know, but it's a tragic ending. And I suppose as I think about Alan Turing, as I think about Ada Lovelace, I think that's what we need, an alternate history kind of ending there, where maybe they both get 70 years each. You know, they each of them had, in a sense, half of a lifetime. And just to allow them more time to develop their ideas, to allow Alan Turing, as an older, distinguished scientist, to come give talks that are videotaped that we could watch now and receive the recognition during his life that he so richly deserved, and for Ada Lovelace to be able to lead a happier life. So that, you know, if I were doing an alternate history kind of story, I'd figure out a way to put Ada Lovelace and Alan Turing together in time somewhere, and they could talk about universal computing machines and, you know, play cards or whatever they would do. So anyway, that's a lot about three books. So again, just to remind you of what was this all about, I was sharing with you my top three books about history of computing and good introductions, not just to personalities, but to technology and so forth. And so remember, go get these books. You should read all these books. Number three is The Soul of a New Machine by Tracy Kidder. Number two is The Thrilling Adventures of Lovelace and Babbage by Sidney Padua. And number one, Alan Turing, The Enigma by Andrew Hodges. So I hope you enjoy these, and I know you will. So thanks.